Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, it's going to be a lot of information. Of course, we're going to begin with the latest on health and healing from around the world so we can live a longer, healthier life. Then, we're going to look at some commentaries from Professor Henry Giroux, Truth Out, on Trump and his proclivity for creating an age of fascist nihilism. We're also going to take a look at some of the latest on what do millennials want? What makes them unique on a positive or negative virtuous scale? What do we contribute to this as their parents? And what responsibility do we have when they enter the real world outside of the bubbles of their family and their schooling, and suddenly they are no longer given all the privileges or the passes for bad behavior? How can we help them? Not punish them, help them. Because there's a big correcting needed. And if we don't do it, it'll be too late. Because my generation, the baby boomers, born between 1945 and 1965, were really the last generation to have all the virtues and values of our greatest generation, our parents, who were born before and during the Great Depression and served in World War II, either abroad or at home. So they had a lot of strength of character and integrity. That was kind of the idealism of America, especially for the working middle class and unions and public education, public works projects. That doesn't exist anymore, except in rare occasion. So when we retire, or we simply stop active participation in society, there'll be no other generation that had the values that we were given, and unfortunately, more often than not, we abandon. So it's a question I'm going to ask you to address a little later on in the program. But there'll be a commentary, and then you'll have a chance to share your points of view. Coming on our next program, I'm doing not one, but two original in-depth investigative reports. In fact, it'll probably take the entire hour. One is on part, our next investigation into autism, brand new article. I just published one yesterday. I'm getting ready for my next article on autism on our next program. Plus, we have another investigative report. I'll hold what the topic is so that the people who is going to be challenging, well, they'll be caught by surprise. It's hard-hitting. But first, the latest on health and healing. And for that, we go to the National Institutes of Environmental Health Science and the National Toxicology Program. Now, I give you that background because I want you to know that what I'm sharing is not hearsay or conspiratorial. It is grounded in good science. And they've concluded there is clear evidence in this laboratory experiment that male rats exposed to high levels of radio frequency radiation, like that used in your G2 and G3 cell phones, develop cancerous heart tumors. And that was according to the final report, which was just released today. There's also some evidence of tumors in the brain and adrenal gland of exposed male rats. And for female rats and male and female mice, the evidence was equivocal as to whether cancers observed were associated with exposure. Now, that's only one of at least 40 studies on rats or humans showing how susceptible we are to these cell phones. But also now with the new internets and the Wi-Fi and the new 5Gs, we are really pulsing everywhere in America. Unless you live somewhere in the middle of a desert or rainforest, you're susceptible. So this is the highest state of evidence, what is called clear evidence. It's not like there's no evidence or equivocal evidence or some evidence. This is definite evidence. And yet it won't make a single bit of difference. That's the bad side, because we get used to our technologies. Indeed, our technologies can be beneficial when used appropriately, but then we become used to them. It's just like I'm going to be doing a program on artificial intelligence, and I mentioned last week that they now have perfected, it's not in the future, it's right now, a robotic that can perform what they call perfect oral sex, and they spend a huge amount of money, and it actually shows you the photographs of all the simulations so they could get everything exactly right. Well, then ask yourself this, how many lonely people are there? And it'll be for men and women. How many lonely people are there who have been in relationships, don't want in a relationship, they sit around and watch porn in their spare time, and if they had a chance to have sex when they wanted it, with no emotional obligations, no hassles, do you think they're not going to say yes? You would have more people purchasing that than you would the 39 million people that just purchased the new cell phone. So what happens when you get used to or addicted to the conveniences of artificial intelligence? For example, now you're shown that in your car, play some of that 1970s jazz, suddenly it's on. What is the capital of Wyoming? You get it in an instant. And then at home, turn out the lights, lower the temperature of my refrigerator, increase the temperature of the heat. Everything's done for you. At some point, you'll lose the desire and the capability of doing something on your own. That's what artificial intelligence is meant to do. Allow you to have all this free time, and everything is done for you. What's it mean when our schools will no longer need teachers? And by the way, that's quickly approaching, because the next stage in artificial intelligence is a person won't have to go to a classroom. They'll be able to take their classes from artificial intelligence in their home. So all those teachers will be out of work, and that's going to be happening in the very near future. Because anything that a teacher could teach you, artificial intelligence could teach you what every teacher in the world that has ever taught knows instantly. And you don't have to put on a uniform, you don't have to buy a textbook, you don't have to do anything. You just have to memorize. And then to pass, you do a recall. But then you get into something really scary. And it's almost here. Almost meaning in the next 3 to 5 years, the first models will happen. And that is transhumanism, where you'll actually be able to interface with the type of cloud computer that can go into your mind and put any kind of thought you want in your mind, any visualization, any virtual reality. So just imagine now you go to a PlayStation, you buy an artificial, you buy a virtual reality headset. So you sit in your home and you're driving a race car or running a marathon, and it might have one or two different virtual realities. But what if every single thought that you wanted, it immediately created in your mind as if it were real? Any thought. What if it would suddenly remember every single thing that you've ever thought of, said, or done in your life? That's the other side of it. That's being developed as we speak, and prototypes are already around. And the military is using it also to create the perfect soldier. And so this is the danger that we're facing from our complacency. Just want to share that with you. We'll be doing a one-hour special on artificial intelligence, a separate one on automation, and a third one on visas, a fourth one on transhumanism over the next month and a half. These will all be our Tuesday night progressive commentary hours. From the University of Erlangen in Nuremberg, Germany, scientists say that chocolate and tea and zinc help make you more healthy. Now, we do a lot on aging. That's where I spent my entire adult life as a research fellow in anti-aging at the Institute of Applied Biology. Lots of studies showing what causes the cell, the DNA, the mitochondria, to prematurely age. How does it age? What role does stress play? Poor diet, nutrient deficiencies, trauma, epigenetics, the environment, viruses and bacteria and microorganisms, parasites. All of these will impact constructively or destructively the DNA, and as a result, we either age much slower than other people or much faster. I was just thinking this morning that Marilyn Monroe was 36 years old when she died, and she came from a very abusive background, was an orphan. Her mother tried to kill her, put a pillow over her and smother her. She had a really bad traumatic experience. She was sexually abused in the home she was in, which would later account for her emotional difficulties. She was with one of the brightest men in America, married to Henry Miller. Arthur Miller. And then she had affairs with Robert F. Kennedy and John F. Kennedy and other people as well. She had everything in the world. Her films earned over $200 million. That's in the 1950s. That's a lot of money based upon today's standards. That would be well over $1 billion. And yet she was miserable. And it didn't help that she was on a lot of psychiatric antidepressants. So then the question is, how old was she? And I was thinking, well, her last film was The Misfits with Clark Gable, and he died at 60 or 61. Errol Flynn died, when you think of him in Robin Hood and the Seahawk, and then you look at him at 50. He had beaten his body, his liver, his kidneys to death. Robert Taylor, John Garfield. Yeah, people who should have lived long lives. They had everything going for them. They lived very short lives. So everything you do in life counts, constructively or destructively. Everything is cumulative. So that's what intrigued me, to see how many different pieces of the puzzle do we have to put together before we see a remarkable change or quantitative change, not just an incremental change. So aging and a low life expectancy are caused, at least partly, by what we call oxidative stress. And a team of researchers from the chair of the bioinorganic chemistry at the Frederick Alexander University, together with researchers in the United States, have discovered that zinc, that simple, inexpensive mineral, can activate an organic molecule helping to protect against oxidative stress. Zinc is a trace mineral. We need it in order to remain healthy. And zinc can protect against the superoxide responsible for oxidative stress when taken together with a component found in resveratrol, green tea, and cacao or chocolate. I'm hopeful that the people in this audience are eating healthy chocolate each day, about 2 ounces, also taking maybe 500 to 1,000 milligrams once or twice a day of non-caffeinated green tea, and also having 15 to 25 milligrams of zinc. If you are, then you're doing a lot of good to reduce oxidative stress, and also by having these, like grapes, a handful of grapes, those are flooding your body with polyphenols. In other words, the plant substance is responsible for the smell and taste. And zinc activates the hydroquinone groups, producing natural protection against superoxide, a byproduct of human cell respiration, which damages the body's own biomolecules. For example, proteins or lipids, as well as the human genome. And that's the interesting part, because the natural living and running and walking club is the only running and walking club that I'm aware of in the world. And it's been around 47 years, almost half a century, that emphasizes not just the training, but the nutrition, because long-distance training in and of itself is immunosuppressive. In fact, so immunosuppressive that a week before the marathon, 100 people volunteered from our group to have their blood workup done at the Tri-State Healing Center. We used Liberty Labs. They took everyone's blood, and it showed that their T cells were under 200. And of course, because they had done so much training, they were fatigued. Well, having under 200 T cells and being fatigued back in the late 80s, that could get you a diagnosis of AIDS. So, but a week to 2 weeks after the marathon, with complete recovery and rest, T cells went back up to 1,500, 1,600, 1,700 normal, and energy came back. The difference is, for every workout that we did, we always ask people to take certain supplements before and after to reduce oxidative stress. So you get the benefit of the exercise, but you don't get the deficiencies in all these other athletes. By the thousands, you'll see that they're going into the marathon with their immune system compromised, colds, flus, because they weren't training holistically. They were of this false belief that all you have to do is just put miles in. Yeah, you can put miles in, and that will help your heart, but it's prematurely aging the mitochondria in your muscles. So one day from all that training, all that racing, you might be 60, but your legs or muscles are probably around 100. And you go to run, and you just can't. You couldn't run a 12-minute mile. And you think, what happened? Well, was you didn't understand the biochemistry of the muscles. I actually had that happen with people I knew. They didn't believe in nutrition, thought it was all nonsense. Just run faster. Well, you got to run smart. So when you take the chocolate and zinc and resveratrol from grapes or grape juice, or as a supplement, you're eliminating the superoxide, and that is what causes the inflammation, lead to cancer, neurodegenerative diseases, COPD, Alzheimer's. It's behind an awful lot of our aging process. So something simple can help us make a difference. Also, good cholesterol can cut a woman's dementia risk. University of Melbourne, 2/3 of people living with dementia are women. And this study confirms that it's now the leading cause of death for women. And yet, there are few studies on how dementia progresses in women. So I took a look at this study. And in the study, brain imaging and behavior, researchers found that a woman's volume of gray matter in her brain at the age of 60 predicts their memory performance at 70. Just so you understand, the gray matter is the part of the brain that nerve cells control, the body's cells. And it's where the real processing happens, including your speech, your hearing, your feelings, your seeing, and your memory. White matter allows communication to and from gray matter areas, as well as between gray matter and other parts of the body. So good cholesterol, meaning an elevated HDL, you end up with less white matter damage in the brain a decade after you've had a healthy lifestyle. So taken together, what it means is simple. Get your cholesterol down. Vitamin E, tocotrienols twice a day. Magnesium twice a day. Glutathione twice a day. And also your neurotransmitters, GABA, your essential fatty acids, vitamin C, all help protect, along with the B-complex, your gray matter. Therefore, you're older, but your brain is not. And finally, from the University of Vermont, researchers are warning chemotherapy causes mitochondrial dysfunction. Now, there are about 268,000 new breast cancers every year in the United States, just this year alone. But what's most disturbing is how vast it is in everyone being treated with risky surgical procedures and highly toxic therapies like chemotherapy. And no one questions it. And if you should survive their therapy, they'll take 100% credit that it was a therapy that caused you to survive. It's like if you get a flu shot and you don't get the flu, 100% of the credit goes to the flu shot. This is science stood on its head. This isn't science. This is stupid. So what they're finding now is that most mainstream media outlets refuse to report on the dangers of conventional cancer care. For example, most cancer patients would be shocked to hear that chemotherapy can increase the risk of heart failure, and in many cases trigger the production of secondary cancers. And one of the main problems stems from how these poisonous medications destroy the health of our mitochondria. And the mitochondria, which are inside our cells, if we don't produce adequate energy throughout our life, it's because of the mitochondria. In other words, this is very serious, and chemotherapy destroys the mitochondria. That's why people with cancer have very little energy. And there's an article published recently in the American Journal of Physiology reveals how patients undergoing cancer treatment suffer mitochondrial dysfunction. So it's not a guess. It's serious and it's real. On our next show, I'll talk about loneliness is a modern illness of the body, not just the mind. But now we're going to take a break and come right back. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you from all over the world. Nice to have you with us today. I'm concerned, and I know many of you are, about what happens when you have a person who has been so desensitized throughout their entire life and career to the consequences of their actions. It is one thing to argue with some accuracy that a person is functionally illiterate, meaning they can go through a day, they can dress themselves, and they can show up for things, but they have no comprehension of the deeper context, of the meaning of anything in their life. And as a result, what they say is of no significance to them, and more often than not, they use words as a form of punishment. They can be extraordinarily abusive in how they speak with people and be indifferent to how that would feel to the person they're leveling a challenge to, a verbal challenge. And that's what we have in our current president. He is the manifestation, for many people, of fascism. I'm talking about the fascism of Benito Mussolini, taking the highest echelons of government and marrying them with the most powerful business forces, where the controlling energy is in the hands of the business elite. In effect, they're running our government. This is fascism, and fascism first begins with linguistic violence and then gains momentum as an organizing force for shaping a culture that legitimates indiscriminate violence against entire groups. Historically, how do you think that so many people began to view blacks or Latinos or Chinese or any indigenous people in America as the other, meaning less than sacred, as they were not in a person's church sitting beside them in their pews? They did not have to be regarded as worthy of trust, worthy of benefit, of benevolence, of love, of respect, of help. None of the above. Think of the Jews. Think of the immigrants. Think of the Muslims. And I'm separating out the Wahhabist from that. These people have historically, according to Professor Drobe, been considered disposable. But then again, an entire part of our society is considered disposable today. Less than the value to be denigrated. Think of the chiropractors who are considered an unscientific cult by Dr. Fishbein, who ran the Journal of the American Medical Association for over 30 years. He had no problem promoting cigarettes and full-page ads or colas or anything else that was bad. That there was no problem with. But for him, he was so fanatical that he created a secret department of investigations to destroy an entire profession. He made no exceptions. Didn't matter what your background was, didn't matter how many people you've helped. If you were a chiropractor, you were an unscientific cultist. The same can be said for homeopaths, holistic nutritionists, chelating doctors, intravenous doctors, body-mind psychologists, holistic nurses, holistic dentists wanting to take the mercury out of your mouth. All of them had something in common. And what was in common was they were disposable. They were never invited into those sacred sanctuaries of orthodoxy, the groups that would bring someone in who had spent their entire life, had never cured a person, but they had gained that unique space of being deferred to because of their power and celebrity status. How many people have you cured, sir? None. Then why are you so revered? We revere power for no other reason than it's able to hold power to itself. But what have you done to deserve that power? What did the Cartesians do to deserve their billion-dollar empire and their celebrity status? Nothing. And that's true of a very vacuous society loaded with people who will do anything to be one of the important ones, the selected ones, not one of the disposable ones. So in a larger context, in this vein, Trump portrays his critics as villains and enemies, describing immigrants as losers and criminals, and has become a national mouthpiece for violent nationalists and a myriad of extremists who trade in hate and violence, using a rhetoric of hate as a performance strategy to whip up those in his base. Not all, but certainly enough to cause a ruckus. Trump employs endless rhetorical tropes of hate and demonization that set the tone for real violence. Trump appears utterly unconcerned by the accusation that his highly charged rhetoric of racial hatred and xenophobia and violent nationalism both legitimates and fuels acts of violence. He proceeds without concern about the consequences of lending his voice to conspiracy theorists claiming that George Soros is funding the caravan of migrant workers. I don't like George Soros. I know how he made his money. But I can't see the proof at this moment. It may exist, but I wouldn't claim it if I couldn't prove it. And how does he know? I don't like Maxine Waters' rhetoric. I considered inflammatory. But he says she has a low IQ. How would he know? And what is the relevance of her IQ? Or referring to former CIA Director John Brennan as a total lowlife and a very bad guy. I don't like John Brennan, but for different reasons, legitimate reasons. Meanwhile, this inflammatory invective promotes violence from the numerous fascist groups that support him. And yet, the people that he should be challenging, the Saudi royal family and the sociopath who is taking control of the entire country, the only absolute monarchy in the world that is sitting side by side with an absolute theocracy, Wahhabism, the most radicalized. If you want to know who the terrorists are, they're not your average Islamic believer. It's those who've been trained in the madrasas, the schools that Saudi Arabia has sponsored around the world. As we speak, inhumanity is erupting in Yemen. I post pictures every day on my Facebook to show this. And yet, we're told nothing will happen. Because we have economic interest. So we're suddenly saying that 29 million human beings who are dying from cholera and starvation, over 100,000 children have already died, that's less value to us than the money that certain corporations or military industrial contractors will make from keeping Saudi in our good graces. And that's true around the world of other countries, Great Britain in particular. That's how it works. So Trump thrives on promoting social divisions and often references violence as a means of addressing them. So in an age of civic literacy and efforts to hold the powerful accountable for their actions and recognize that most of the mainstream media engages in biased news, ignorance becomes the breeding ground, not just for hate, but for a culture that represses historical memory and shreds any understanding of the importance of shared values and refuses to make tolerance a non-negotiable element of civic dialogue and allows the powerful to weaponize everyday discourse. Trump's language is neither harmless nor merely a form of infantile theater. It is toxic, steeped in a racist nationalist construct that stirs up and emboldens extremist elements. And yet, he is not held accountable. So this is bad. And this is getting worse, just like the environment that no one seems to be paying attention to. The scientists who have the courage to come forward, they've been dismissed. They're no longer invited to share their points of view. Just like the holistic doctor who's curing their patients without medicines or the protocols that they were trained in is dismissed as irrelevant. And the sociologist and the psychologist and the behavioralist who are saying, before we condemn an entire generation living in poverty to substandard expectations, why don't we see what it would be like if we change the circumstances in which they're living and give them a support system that allows them a chance to grow and thrive? But we won't do that. I'm concerned. I'm concerned that we have become an uncivil society and that we don't appreciate how powerful our words are when they've been weaponized. Remember, it's not just the police that have been weaponized. It is identity politics on steroids. I'm Gary Null, and we're going to take another break. Come right back. Please stay with us. Nice to have you with us today, everyone. What do you believe would be the best remedial actions to help create a new dialogue with younger people, at least those younger people who have lived in this kind of ethereal bubble of perfection? You're perfect, darling. You can't make mistakes. And if anyone says that they wouldn't hire you, we'll come down there and just beat the hell out of them. And your teacher, well, she gave you an A-. You deserve an A+, even if you never opened a book or took a test. Wow. And these are the kids going to college and saying, my life feels threatened, and I'm here at Harvard. No, you're not threatened by anything except your parents' stupidity. What do we do? I have ideas. I'd like to hear yours. 888-874-4888. 888-874-4888. And let's see if we can get some calls. In the interim, we'll let you know we got a special day on my new product, Energy Stuff. Energy Stuff. You don't want those very toxic commercial products loaded with caffeine and artificial flavors and sweeteners. No, those are not good for you. Just look at the peer review science. So I decided to create a product. It took me over a year and a half to do this. Here's what's in my energy stuff. Organic cordyceps mushroom, coenzyme Q10, D-ribose, vitamin B12, acetyl-L-carnitine, Panax ginseng, green tea extract, L-carnosine, electrolytes and sodium citrate, magnesium citrate, and potassium citrate, ginkgo biloba, cayenne pepper, rhodiola rosea, L-taurine, L-arginine, creatine monohydrate with organic stevia. It is delicious, and boy, is it good. It only has something like, what's the calories on it? It's very low, 62 calories. And I suggest this for anyone before you go for a workout. Just take one scoop of the powder, put it in any liquid you want, and drink it down and see how your workout goes. If you're feeling a little groggy in the middle of the day, a little tired, just take a scoop of this in any liquid instead of having coffee. But I also have one other thing, because I get so many requests for information on getting a better night's sleep, and I give all the information. I've done it so many times, and I have an article, and it's posted today on Perian.fm on insomnia to help you. And this, however, you would take 2 hours before you'd want to go to sleep. And I put in here passion flower extract, valerian root extract, chamomile extract, ashwagandha extract, melatonin, L-theanine, hops, reishi mushroom, lipase, amylase, protease, inulin, jasmine, stevia, griffonia extract, which is 5-hydrotryptophan, GABA, magnesium citrate, lemon balm, skullcap, catnip. Yeah. There's no more powerful, all-inclusive sleep formula that I'm aware of in the world. So that's what you get. Plus, we have right now back in stock, I was just told, our anti-aging elixir. And if there's one thing that I've created that is really, there is no one anywhere who I've seen even try to duplicate this, because it would be prohibitively expensive for them to do it. And I know they couldn't source all this material. I know how long it took me to source this material. And I make this in small batches, about 800 bottles. It's a big bottle. It's almost 34 ounces. Listen to the ingredients of the anti-aging elixir. If there's one single product that you need and you can't get any others, the anti-aging elixir. Organic apple juice and mangosteen, organic tart cherry, organic pomegranate, organic SI, organic nopal, organic noni, and organic turmeric, and ginger, and sea buckthorn juice, and vitamin C, organic mango, and organic papaya, and pectin, and organic guar, and natural mangosteen, and organic lychee, and organic beetroot, and organic aloe vera, and goji, and wolfberry, and elderberry, and cranberry, and blueberries, and kakadu, and organic moringa, and organic baobab, the oldest tree that I know of in the world, organic macaque, organic stevia. There's nothing like this. Now, you got to shake it before you use it, because I didn't put any emulsifiers. I didn't homogenize it. This is as pure a product as is possible to get. And this is the real McCoy. So that's the, those are the three that I have back in stock right now. And these are all good. So I just wanted to share this with, because we haven't had a special in a while. And anyone in this audience who would like to get those, call this number. The sleep stuff, the energy stuff, and the, you can buy them separately or together, all on sale. Call 877-627-5065. 877-627-5065. Now we're going to go to a little clip And this particular clip is this is why the over 70 vaccines on our kids' CDC recommended schedule is crazy, irresponsible, non-scientific. But listen in.
Is there any comment on using this vaccine at the same time with other adjuvanted vaccines?
We have no data to make a recommendation one way or the other.
So just to sort of put this in context of other vaccines, while preclinical studies were not done using these vaccines simultaneously, our general approach to immunizations is that they should be given, they can be given at the same time in different limbs.
Dr. Hunter?
Are adjuvanted, multiple adjuvanted vaccines used in Europe or other markets?
Dr. Ward, do you want to comment?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. I think unless there's any further discussion, we will take a vote on this recommendation.
Okay. I want to remind everyone to please check your voting whatever machine thing, and voting is open.
Thank you very much. So the voting is completed, and it is unanimous to support this recommendation. Thank you all.
And does anybody around the table, we don't need to go around and verify our votes, but does anybody have any comments they wish to make about their vote?
Great.
Sarah, just a slight reservation. I think this is a huge advance and a step forward. I am concerned about that signal, that myocardial infarction signal. I am concerned about the use of this new adjuvant, and certainly urge us to continue to look at the post-marketing data carefully.
Dr. Hunter?
Just a question about that. How soon would we be getting that post-marketing data update here?
There's two kinds of data. The vaccine safety data link data will require people to be using the vaccine to develop substantive database. And Dr. Sun, do you want to comment on the post-marketing data that FDA is requiring?
I think for the myocardial infarction study, we're seeing that the date for or likely for completion is May 31, 2020. There will also be studies looking at autoimmune diseases as well as herpes zoster, and there will be a pregnancy registry as well. So that's all included in the post-marketing surveillance.
Listen to what you just heard. This is how exactly vitamins are passed. I want you to hear the insanity of this. He says, oh yeah, I'm concerned about that myocardial. That's a heart attack. Oh, and autoimmune diseases. When will we find out if the vaccines cause these? Well, first they have to use the vaccines. Then we'll see how many heart attacks and these other conditions occur, and that'll be around 2020. So we're going to expose tens of millions of children to known toxins, including in their own studies that they just acknowledged. And these are the scientists on the medical doctors and scientists on the FDA and the CDC's a science advisory panel on vaccines. They're acknowledging heart attacks and many other conditions, but they're going to wait and use a group of children as human guinea pigs. So for the pro-vaccine people, this shows you the level of corruption that exists in the field. Just thought you should hear that. And now I'm going to go to the segment, If You're a Millennial. And we're not going to play the whole thing. It's posted on PRN.fm. I'm going to play enough, and so you get an idea of how important this is to understand who's coming into the marketplace and how we're going to work with them. If you've never worked with a millennial, and if you're unfortunate enough to get the average millennial, then you'll understand what he's saying. Let's listen in now.
You have a meeting where somebody doesn't ask me the millennial question. What's the millennial question? Apparently, millennials as a generation, which is a group of people who were born approximately 1984 and after, are tough to manage. and they're accused of being entitled and narcissistic, and self-interested, unfocused, lazy. But entitled is the big one. And because they confound leadership so much, what's happening is leaders are asking the millennials, what do you want? And millennials are saying, we want to work in a place with purpose, love that. We want to make an impact, you know, whatever that means. We want free food and beanbags. And so somebody articulates some sort of purpose. There's lots of free food and there's beanbags, and yet for some reason, they're still not happy. And that's because they're missing. There's a missing piece. What I've learned is that I can break it down into four pieces. Right? There are four things, four characteristics. One is parenting. The other one is technology. The third is impatience, and the fourth is environment. The generation that we call the millennials, too many of them grew up subject to, not my words, failed parenting strategies. Where, for example, they were told that they were special all the time. They were told that they could have anything they want in life, just because they want it. Some of them got into honors classes, not because they deserved it, but because their parents complained. And some of them got A's, not because they earned them, but because the teachers didn't want to deal with the parents. Some kids got participation medals. You got a medal for coming in last, right? Which the science we know is pretty clear, which is it devalues the medal and the reward for those who actually work hard, and that actually makes the person who comes in last feel embarrassed because they know they didn't deserve it, so it actually makes them feel worse, right? So you take this group of people, and they graduate school, and they get a job, and they're thrust into the real world, and in an instant, they find out they're not special, their moms can't get them a promotion, that you get nothing for coming in last, and by the way, you can't just have it because you want it. And in an instant, their entire self-image is shattered. And so you have an entire generation that's growing up with lower self-esteem than previous generations. The other problem, to compound it, is we're growing up in a Facebook, Instagram world. In other words, we're good at putting filters on things. We're good at showing people that life is amazing even though I'm depressed. And so everybody sounds tough, and everybody sounds like they got it all figured out. And the reality is there's very little toughness, and most people don't have it figured out. And so when the more senior people say, well, what should we do? They sound like, this is what you gotta do. And they have no clue, right? So you have an entire generation growing up with lower self-esteem than previous generations, right? Through no fault of their own, right? They were dealt a bad hand. Now let's add in technology. We know that engagement with social media and our cell phones releases a chemical called dopamine. That's why when you get a text, it feels good, right? So, you know, we've all had it where you're feeling a little bit down or feeling a bit lonely, and so you send out 10 texts to 10 friends, you know, hi, because it feels good when you get a response. It's why we count the likes, it's why we go back 10 times to see if my Instagram is growing slower, did I do something wrong? Do they not like me anymore, right? The trauma for young kids to be unfriended, right? Because we know when you get a hit of dopamine, which feels good. It's why we like it, it's why we keep going back to it. Dopamine is the exact same chemical that makes us feel good when we smoke, when we drink, and when we gamble. In other words, it's highly, highly addictive, right? We have age restrictions on smoking, gambling, and alcohol, and we have no age restrictions on social media and cell phones, which is the equivalent of opening up the liquor cabinet and saying to our teenagers, hey, by the way, this adolescence thing, if it gets you down... But that's basically what's happening. That's basically what's happening, right? That's basically what happened. You have an entire generation that has access to an addictive, numbing chemical called dopamine through social media and cell phones as they're going through the high stress of adolescence. Why is this important? Almost every alcoholic discovered alcohol when they were teenagers. When we're very, very young, the only approval we need is the approval of our parents. And as we go through adolescence, we make this transition where we now need the approval of our peers. Very frustrating for our parents, very important for us. It allows us to acculturate outside of our immediate families into the broader tribe, right? It's a highly, highly stressful and anxious period of our lives, and we're supposed to learn to rely on our friends. Some people, quite by accident, discover alcohol and numbing effects of dopamine to help them cope with the stresses and anxieties of adolescence. Unfortunately, that becomes hardwired in their brains, and for the rest of their lives, when they suffer significant stress, they will not turn to a person, they will turn to the bottle. Social stress, financial stress, career stress, that's pretty much the primary reasons why an alcoholic drinks, right? What's happening is, because we're allowing unfettered access to these dopamine-producing devices and media, basically it's becoming hardwired, and what we're seeing is, as they grow older, too many kids don't know how to form deep, meaningful relationships. Their words, not mine. They will admit that many of their friendships are superficial. They will admit that their friends, that they don't count on their friends, they don't rely on their friends, they have fun with their friends, but they also know that their friends will cancel on them if something better comes along. Deep, meaningful relationships are not there because they never practice the skill set, and worse, they don't have the coping mechanisms to deal with stress. So when significant stress starts to show up in their lives, they're not turning to a person, they're turning to a device, they're turning to social media, they're turning to these things which offer temporary relief. We know, the science is clear, we know that people who spend more time on Facebook suffer higher rates of depression than people who spend less time on Facebook. These things balanced. Alcohol is not bad, too much alcohol is bad. Gambling is fun, too much gambling is dangerous. There's nothing wrong with social media and cell phones. It's the imbalance. If you're sitting at dinner with your friends and you're texting somebody who's not there, that's a problem. That's an addiction. If you're sitting in a meeting with people you're supposed to be listening to and speaking, and you put your phone on the table, face up or face down, I don't care, that sends a subconscious message to the room that you're just not that important to me right now, right? That's what happens. And the fact that you cannot put it away is because you are addicted, right? If you wake up and you check your phone before you say good morning to your girlfriend, boyfriend, or spouse, you have an addiction. And like all addiction, in time, it'll destroy relationships, it'll cost time, and it'll cost money, and it'll make your life worse. So you have a generation growing up with lower self-esteem that doesn't have the coping mechanisms to deal with stress. Now you add in the sense of impatience. They've grown up in a world of instant gratification. You wanna buy something, you go on Amazon, it arrives the next day. You wanna watch a movie? Log on and watch a movie. You don't check movie times. You wanna watch a TV show? Binge. You don't even have to wait week to week to week, right? I know people who skip seasons just so they can binge at the end of the season, right? Instant gratification. You wanna go on a date? You don't even have to learn how to be like, hey. You don't even have to learn and practice that skill. You don't have to be the uncomfortable one who says yes when you mean no and says no when you mean no and yes when you... You don't have to swipe right. Bang, I'm a stud. Right? You don't even have to learn the social coping mechanisms. Everything you want, you can have instantaneously. Everything you want, instant gratification. Except job satisfaction and strength of relationships, there ain't no app for that. They are slow, meandering, uncomfortable, messy processes. And so I keep meeting these wonderful, fantastic, idealistic, hardworking, smart kids. They've just graduated school. They're in their entry-level job. I sit down with them and I go, how's it going? They go, I think I'm gonna quit. I'm like, why? They're like, I'm not making an impact. I'm like, you've been here 8 months. You know? It's as if they're standing at the foot of a mountain and they have this abstract concept called impact that they wanna have in the world, which is the summit. What they don't see is the mountain. I don't care if you go up the mountain quickly or slowly, but there's still a mountain. And so what this young generation needs to learn is patience. That some things that really, really matter, like love, or job fulfillment, joy, love of life, self-confidence, a skill set, any of these things, all of these things take time. Sometimes you can expedite pieces of it, but the overall journey is arduous and long and difficult. And if you don't ask for help and learn that skill set, you will fall off the mountain. Or you will, the worst case scenario, and we're already seeing it, the worst case scenario is we're seeing an increase in suicide rates. We're seeing an increase in this generation. We're seeing an increase in accidental deaths due to drug overdoses. We're seeing more and more kids drop out of school or take leaves of absence due to depression. Unheard of. This is really bad. The best case scenario, those are all bad cases, right? The best case scenario is you'll have an entire population growing up and going through life and just never really finding joy. They'll never really find deep, deep fulfillment in work or in life. They'll just waft through life and it'll be just, it's fine. How's your job? It's fine, the same as yesterday. How's your relationship? It's fine. Like, that's the best case scenario. Which leads me to the fourth point, which is environment. Which is, we're taking this amazing group of young, fantastic kids who are just dealt a bad hand. It's no fault of their own. And we put them in corporate environments that care more about the numbers than they do about the kids. They care more about the short-term gains than the long-term life of this young human being. We care more about the year than the lifetime, right? And so we are putting them in corporate environments that aren't helping them build their confidence, that aren't helping them learn the skills of cooperation, that aren't helping them overcome the challenges of a digital world and finding more balance, that isn't helping them overcome the need to have instant gratification and teach them the joys and impact and the fulfillment you get from working hard over on something for a long time that cannot be done in a month or even in a year. And so we're thrusting to them in corporate environments, and the worst part about it is they think it's them. They blame themselves. They think it's them who can't deal. And so it makes it all worse. It's not. I'm here to tell them it's not them. It's the corporations, it's the corporate environments, it's the total lack of good leadership in our world today that is making them feel the way they do. They were dealt a bad hand, and I hate to say it, but it's the company's responsibility. Sucks to be you, like we have no choice, right? This is what we got, and I wish that society and their parents did a better job. They didn't. So we're getting them in our companies, and we now have to pick up the slack. We have to work extra hard to figure out the ways that we build their confidence. We have to work extra hard to find ways to teach them the social skills that they're missing out on. There should be no cell phones in companies.
There should be no cell phones, I agree, but it's not for us to build their self-confidence. You cannot instill in someone what they're not willing to find for themselves. All we can do is be guides for them. I'd like to see some of your thoughts. Send them by text, prnstudio@gmail.com. How do you view this problem, and what would you suggest as solutions? We have one caller. We'll take one caller before the end of the show. Hi, you're on the
Hi.
Air.
Hi, Gary. It's Marcia.
Hi, Marcia.
And I've been wanting to tell you that I reached my 92nd birthday in September. And
well, congratulations.
What's that?
I said congratulations.
Thank you. And doing all the things that you suggest using the products. And this is someone who was told at 5 years old that, well, if we put her in a glass cage, maybe she'll grow up. And very sickly childhood, and here I am, and functioning, and happy, and published a book at 91, so it can be done.
Do you have a website, Marcia?
Yes, lifemotivatingcounseling.com at MSN, MSN.com.
Say that again, please.
Life. Motivating Counseling at MSN.com.
Well, Marcia, hopefully people go there and see if you're at 92 and you're going strong and you published a book at 91, that should tell people what's possible and they shouldn't give up and you're never too old. Well,
Can
good
I
for
say
you.
The name of my book?
Certainly.
From Birth to Death with Sex in Between.
Good for you. Still have a good sex life?
Definitely. Definitely. Definitely.
Good for you, Marcia. Thank you for calling. I'm Gary Null. We're out of time. Thank you all for listening. Look forward to our next program. Have a nice day.
Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a big hey, party, man.
Mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, there's far too many of you.